إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، تركنا على لمحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك ولا ينتظم في سلكها إلا سالك. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه في الأولين وفي الآخرين وفي الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. يقول عز من قائل: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. In the name of Allah, the gracious, the merciful, to Him we belong and to Him we shall return. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His infinite grace and boundless mercy to send an abundance of prayers and peace upon our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon us and to have mercy upon our loved ones and to have mercy upon our deceased. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon this ummah and grant relief to those who are in pain and grant coolness to those who are in a state of hardship and difficulty. May God relieve those who are facing hardships across this world. Allahumma ameen ya rabbil alameen. Brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran, He says in Surah Al-Ahzab, "An-Nabiyyu awla bil-mu'mineena min anfusihim wa azwajuhu ummahatuhum." Sadaqallahu al-azim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this beautiful and profound verse notes that He, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, takes preference in the hearts and minds of the believers over themselves. That in the ethos of a believer, someone who says La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, who believes in God and who believes in God's messengers and who believes in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam as the last and final messenger of God, these are people who in their hearts and in their minds, the Prophet Muhammad takes preference. That the vehicle through which and by which a believer views this world is through the lens of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That when I come to deal with my loved ones, my spouse, my friends, my family, my community, my co-workers, my society, regardless of the object of my concern, a believer is someone who puts the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam first. To assess the ethic and the spirit of how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would apply himself in that moment. So if I'm dealing with my loved one, my spouse, with my family, I'm summoning prophetic mercy, prophetic love, prophetic compassion. When I'm dealing with injustice, I'm summoning prophetic justice. I'm seeing and seeking to remove hardship from upon anyone who is a human being, who has a soul that is breathed into them. I strive to remove that hardship from upon them. That is what it means for a believer to say that the Prophet comes first even before myself. And that is what affirms the Prophet when he himself said that you cannot be a complete believer until you love God and you love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam more than you love yourself, more than you love your wealth, more than you love your family, more than you love your children, more than you love your parents. The way to become a complete believer is to put the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam first. But God continues and He tells us and He explores with us, how do we think about those who are in the intimate, close proximity of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? And He says, "Wa azwajuhu ummahatuhum." And the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they are the mothers of the believers. And it is so profound that God, when He chooses to speak about those who are in intimate proximity to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, He speaks about them in the language of motherhood. That when you think about the Prophet, you think about the person that you put before anything else, even yourself. And when you think about his wives, his blessed wives, you think about them as your mother. And the mother in our tradition is a sacred entity. The mother is an entity that carries within her the sacredness of life and the secret of the human condition. So she's sanctified, she's loved, she's honored, she's respected, she's cared for. She is never to be belittled or insulted or disregarded or neglected. For us, as we know, the heavens run, the rivers of heaven run beneath the feet of our mothers. And so imagine when God is telling you that the prophet's wife, the prophet's wives, they are your mother. And that is how all of the prophet's companions, all of the prophet's followers, from that day until this day, thought about the prophet's wives as their mothers. And so when we as a community are exploring this idea of living prophetically, we take those who were in the intimate proximity of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as our shining stars, as our bright lights to follow in their footsteps, to try to live to the best of our capacity prophetically, following in the footsteps of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of those individuals, one of those mothers, the most beloved to the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was As-Siddiqa bint As-Siddiq. As-Siddiqa Aisha bint Abi Bakr radiyallahu anhuma wa ardahuma. Our mother Aisha was the most beloved to our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Habibatul Habib. She was the beloved of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And she was As-Siddiqa. That was one of her titles. And she inherited that in many ways from her father, Abu Bakr As-Siddiq, the one we spoke about last week. Because she was profoundly truthful in her commitment to Allahu Jalla wa Ala. She was profoundly truthful in her commitment to following in the footsteps of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And she embodied all of the prophetic virtues in a way that we can only aspire to be even 1/100th of what she was. Our mother Aisha, she excelled in all of the prophetic spheres that we've been talking about over the past year and a half. The sphere of ilm, the sphere of knowledge, she was excellent. The sphere of spirituality, lived spirituality, she was a profoundly spiritual being. In the sphere of community, she was an exemplar in how an individual should be a family member, to be a loving, caring spouse, and to care for her community. And she was a person of profound service, and I hope to explore these four spheres this afternoon. Brothers and sisters, when we look at our mother Aisha and we see what those early companions would say about her, all of them collectively would note that she was أَفْقَهُ النَّاسِ وَأَعْلَمُ النَّاسِ وَأَحْسَنُ النَّاسِ رَأْيًا. That she was amongst the most knowledgeable of people. This is by the authority of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, one of the great companions of the Prophet. He said she was the most learned of people and the most knowledgeable of people. And she was a person who had the best opinion, the best thought, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha was. Because in her home, in her close company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she experienced revelation the way no other person experienced revelation. بيتها كان مهبط الوحي. Her home, her quarters, which were directly stuck to the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, her home was where revelation descended. And the Prophet, he said that no one experienced revelation the way Aisha, my beloved Aisha, experienced revelation. Out of all of the Prophet's wives, she was the only one who was present time and time again when revelation came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That at times she would be sitting and the Prophet's blessed head would be on her lap, and she would experience revelation vicariously as it came to him. She said that his head became so heavy that I felt my leg was going to break by how intense revelation was. Imagine that was her living experience in the close company of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So who else do we go to really explore this idea of living out a prophetic ethic, living prophetically other than someone like our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. She was loved and honored by all of the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And in the realm of scholarship, she was amongst the few. The scholars tell us that from the jurists of Medina, there were seven amongst the fuqaha of the Sahaba, the scholars of the companions were seven, and one of them, if not amongst the most knowledgeable amongst them, was our mother Aisha. And during the rule of Abu Bakr, and during the rule of Umar, and during the rule of Uthman, and after that, until the day she died, Al-Qasim, he says that كانت لها الفتية. She was the one who was given the space of juridical ruling. She was the one who would give opinions, legal opinions, dispense legal opinions. It was her. When all of those individuals were present, she was the one who was given the station as the chief jurist. Subhanallah. Imagine that. Think about that. Think about a woman who only spent 9 years with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she lived for 47 years after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died. But amongst the narrators of prophetic tradition, she was number four. She narrated 2,250 prophetic traditions. And over 290 of the Prophet's companions and tabi'een, the followers of the companions, narrated on her authority. Everyone that you can think of from our righteous predecessors would narrate on the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha. Even the likes of Sayyiduna Umar, who was the ultimate alpha Arabian male, if you want to say that, and who was at the age of her father, because he was the close company of Abu Bakr, and Sayyidina Aisha was the daughter of Abu Bakr. Sayyidina Umar, we have a number of narrations where it is عن عمر عن عائشة رضي الله عنه. And I want you to take a moment to process what that means. To process what it means for a woman who was his daughter's age, for him to go and sit at her feet and to take from her prophetic guidance. Where else in the world was that even remotely happening? Where an entire civilization that was remarkably male-driven and women were treated in all sorts of ways. But here you have Umar radiallahu anh going and sitting at her feet to take hadith from her. What does that tell you? That tells you that he is someone who was a true believer. Because as we said in the beginning of the sermon, النبي أولى بالمؤمنين من أنفسهم. Umar radiallahu anh knew that prophetic guidance was to take precedence and prominence over anything, especially the ego and especially the self. There is no giving preference to my ego. Well, I'm a strong, you know, chieftain of my tribe. How can I go to a girl who's my daughter, my daughter's age, and take any type of guidance from her? He didn't say that. Because he lived prophetically. He embodied the spirit of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He embodied the spirit of prophecy. When someone humbles themselves to truth, regardless of that source, regardless of where the truth is coming from, the believer is someone who humbles themselves to truth and sits at the feet of anyone who has knowledge and wisdom and guidance to be offered. Our mother Aisha, she thrived in that space. She was not only a scholar, a legal scholar, but she was a scholar of tafsir. She would explain the verses of Quran to the companions. To the extent that she had her own individual opinions about particular ayat and ahadith. The famous hadith that is narrated upon some of the companions, where it is said that the deceased is tortured by the tears of their loved ones. She said that is not what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant to say. And she gave a long explanation. But she said, because the verse of the Quran where Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى, that no one is to bear the harsh or harmful acts of another. So there is no, in the fatwa, in the opinion of our mother Aisha, no deceased person amongst the believers is harmed by the tears of their loved ones. Because the Quran was to be given prominence in that point. She was a scholar of faqiha. She explored the Quran and the hadith. She was even a scholar of genealogy. She was extremely knowledgeable in geopolitics. We knew that her father was himself a nasab, a genealogist. He knew the tribes and the peoples. He could explore someone's entire history just by learning the basics of their person's name and where they came from or their region or their tribe. She was one of the main people that the companions, especially after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, she was one of the main people that they would go to, especially when they were going out for their expeditions. They would take her counsel and her advice and her guidance. She was one of the companions, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, was astonished. He said, you know, he said to her, I understand that you have scholarly knowledge in terms of legalities, halal and haram, Quran, tafsir, but how do you have so much knowledge about medicine? She was a scholar in medicine. She said that because as I served the Muslim community and I served my beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I would regularly be in the company of medical doctors, of people who were experts in medicine. And especially in the waning months of the Prophet's life as he was ill and people were traveling from all sorts of places in the world to come and treat him, she learned from them medicine to the extent that she became herself an expert in medicine. Brothers and sisters, this is just a drop in the bucket of the scholarly, intellectual excellence of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. She was a person who had her own school in the Prophet's mosque. And from her school, which was right next to her quarters, her sleeping quarters, graduated hundreds and hundreds of tabi'een and companions who learned from her, who say that she was their primary teacher. Al-Qasim says that she was my primary teacher and I studied with the ocean of Ibn Abbas and the ocean of Ibn Umar, but she was my primary teacher. Radiallahu anhum ajma'in. Brothers and sisters, this compels us for ourselves, each and every single one of us, to explore our own intellectual pursuits. As a community of believers, we know the importance of intellectual excellence, to be scholars of both text and context. And we see this beautifully exemplified in the person of our mother Aisha. But she wasn't just simply intellectually miraculous, beautiful and excellent, but she was also a deeply spiritual person. Our mother Aisha radiallahu anha was sawwama qawwama. She is someone who fasted all the time. كانت تصوم الدهر, as some of the companions would say, she would fast all year round, except for the days that you're not allowed to fast in. وكانت تصوم في السفر وفي الحضر. She would fast whether she was in travel or she was home. She was always fasting. And she was someone who would pray in the night. Because we know that the excellence of a believer is not just in the realm of intellectual excellence, to be a knowledge, be a person of knowledge or scholarship, but it is a matter of spiritual excellence. And that is something that she embodied from being in the close and intimate company of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because we know the endless narrations of how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would wake up in the middle of the night and he would ask permission of his beloved Aisha, would you allow me to pray 2 units of prayer? And she saw him every single night in that state, praying to Allah. And that became her own hal. Her own state was one where she prayed all night for the remainder of the entirety of her life. To the extent that Al-Qasim, her nephew, who would go to her regularly every day, he would visit her and pass by her home to check up on her. He found her one night standing in prayer, weeping. And she was reciting the verse, فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا وَوَقَانَا عَذَابَ السَّمُومِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has conferred His favor upon us and He has saved us from the torment of hellfire. Al-Qasim says that she kept on reciting that verse, فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا, and she would weep and weep. So he waited and he waited just to check up on her. But she never responded. So he came back hours later, and she was still standing, and she was still weeping. فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا. She was someone, you can only imagine the spiritual state that she was in, the reflection that she was engaged in as she was thinking about all of the blessings that God has conferred upon the believer. And in these particular set of verses, it is referring to the believer when they are in heaven. And they're speaking about the blessings that God has conferred upon them by being in heaven. And the possibility, and you can only imagine what she was thinking about. That she had this deep hope that she will be granted the greatest gift, and that is being in heaven and being back with her beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And at the same time, she was fearful of the possibility of hellfire. And so she stood in that spiritual state crying to God. And that was the exact state that she would see her husband in time and time again. As he cried, as he was reciting the verses of the Quran. And she would ask him, Ya Rasulullah, why do you cry while you pray in that way? He says, how can I not cry when God has revealed to me, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار. She would say, how can, the Prophet would say, how can I not cry when on this night it was revealed to me that verily in the creations of the heavens and the earth, in the alternation of the night and the day, are signs for people who have hearts. And the people who have hearts are those who remember God while they're standing and while they're sitting and while they're on their sides. And they say to themselves, God, verily, you have not created this for naught. You have not created this world haphazardly, but rather you have created it so that we can know you and we can worship you and we can submit to you. So that is the spirit that she embodied, a deeply spiritual person. And all of the companions would see her in that state and they would say, ذَاكَ أُمُّنَا عَائِشَا. That is our mother Aisha, the mother of the believers. And by the way, that was how they referred to her, Ummuna. And those who were not only younger than her, but those who were 10 and 20 and 30 and 40 and 50 years older than her, they would say, that is our mother Aisha. Because she was a spiritual womb for them. She had that beautiful, intimate proximity to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So she exuded spirituality. Number three, the third of our prophetic spheres is the sphere of community, the sphere of intimate family. And there is no better example of a beautiful and happy marriage than the one that existed between our mother Aisha and our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A marriage that is truly embedded in our history books as one of the greatest marriages. The exemplification of how a husband and wife should love each other, be merciful with each other, be empathetic to one another, be caring of one another, be sacrificial for one another, to sacrifice my own well-being and my own comforts and my own likes for my beloved loved one. And that's when the Prophet ﷺ would come and ask her, would you allow me to pray two units of prayer in the night? She would say, Ya Rasulullah, of course I love when you are close to me and when you are lying down next to me. But nothing is more beloved to me than what you love to do. And if you love to pray, then please do that. Look at a man, a prophet of God, who's asking his wife permission to pray, and how his wife grants him an allowance to pray, but in the most beautiful language. And that was the spirit of their relationship. It was love and compassion all the time. When the Prophet ﷺ would see her down, he would go and he would find the glass that she was drinking from, and he would hold the glass and he would look, and she would see him doing this. He would look for the place where she put her lips, so he would drink from the same exact spot to lift her spirits, to make her feel happy once again. He would race with her. In the open fields, he would race. One time they raced, And Sayyidah Aisha won. She won the race. They were in the open desert. He said, let's race. Put a starting point. They ran the end point. She won. Many years later, the Prophet ﷺ said, we need a redo. I need a rematch. And so they raced. And this time the Prophet ﷺ won. And he poked her belly. He said, هَذِهِ بِتِلْكِ You know, you won last time, I won this time. And that was the spirit of their relationship through and through. It was always love and compassion, always love and care. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when asked by one of the companions, who is the most beloved to you? Amr ibn al-As was one of the great companions of the Prophet. He was coming back from an expedition, that to Salasil, and he was so happy because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so happy with him after that expedition. And so he assumed that he's going to go to the Prophet and ask him, who is the most beloved to you? And that the Prophet ﷺ would say, of course you are. But he didn't. The Prophet ﷺ was asked, who is the most beloved to you? He said, Aisha. She is the most beloved to me. Who after that, Ya Rasulullah? Her father, Abu Bakr. He is the most beloved to me. Who, Ya Rasulullah, after that? Umar. And then he stopped asking, fearing that his name wouldn't be mentioned. But he knew that the Prophet ﷺ loved him. But the Prophet, I want us to once again really explore this idea that a man of such profound standing in the Arabian Peninsula, in that time, 1400 years ago, a leader amongst leaders, to stand firmly and confidently and proudly to say, my most beloved is my wife, Aisha. Think about that. Many of us today were embarrassed very often to even refer to our loved ones, to our wife or our husband. We're ashamed at times, almost as if we're embarrassed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not ashamed or embarrassed. For him, it was his honor. And he would say, ذَكَ أُمُّكُمْ. When he would sit down with the companions, he would teach them that language. That is your mother, Aisha. That is your mother. Sallallahu ala habibina, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What an example of what it means to be a real man. A man who loves, a man who's full of compassion and care. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam died, he was on Aisha's lap. It was in her quarters as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was being taken care of by her. And he was asking her and telling her, what do you think about what I should do? And I want this to happen and that to happen. And he would say to her, I'm going to have Abu Bakr, you know, lead prayer. And she would say, no, Ya Rasulullah, don't have my father lead prayer, because he's someone who cries a lot in prayer. Look at the beautiful conversational state that they were in. That when there were a group of Ethiopians who came and they were doing a performance in the Prophet's mosque, and he knew that his beloved wanted to watch, He let her stand up a little bit, and he kneeled down, and she perched her head over his shoulder so that she can watch. And she had her cheek stuck to his cheek. And he kept on asking her, are you sufficed? Are you happy? And she would say, no, I want to watch a little bit more. And although she was not that interested in watching anymore, but it was the fact that she had her cheek next to the cheek of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Brothers and sisters, I illustrate all of this to say that at the heart and soul of a good community is intimacy in marriage. It is love and compassion in our homes. It is families that thrive the way that the homes of the Prophet ﷺ thrived. When a husband and wife are not egotistical, they're not self-serving, they're not seeking their own whims and desires and their own pleasures, but rather they put forth first and foremost, ahead of anything, the pleasures and the happiness and the joy of their spouse and their children. That was the spirit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that was the spirit of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. And lastly, the fourth of our prophetic spheres is the sphere of service. Our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, brothers and sisters, was an extremely giving person. After the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and even during his life, she was given obviously, as her standing, constantly she would be receiving money, the portion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But following in the Prophet's footsteps, she never kept any of the money. We have narrations that she received 100,000 dirhams. And she was fasting in the middle of the day. And before sunset, she had passed out to the needy all of the money. Every penny of the 100,000 dirhams. And so her helper came to her and said, you know, couldn't you at least keep one dirham so that I can get you something to break your fast with? She said, I didn't even think of that. She didn't even think of the fact that she's fasting and she has to break her fast. And I want you to think about that when you're breaking your fast in a little over 2 months. Because some people, when it's just an hour before iftar, you don't even get near them because they're rabid and they're ready to eat. But she wasn't even thinking of her own state. It was just, I need to give and give in abundance. And she experienced that with the Prophet every single day. She says that 3 months would pass by and we wouldn't have the necessary means or tools to put together a fire. Just a simple fire in the home. She would say for 3 months we would not be able to put a fire in our home. That for periods and periods of time, she would say the only thing that was in our home was al-aswadan, dates and water. That for periods of time, that would be the only thing in her home. All of the fuqara, all of those who were poor and needy and in destitute states, they knew that they could go to Aisha, the mother of the believers, the beloved of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this beautifully spiritual person, they knew that they could go to her and they could find relief. They could find a warm, motherly heart with that which what was in a spiritual state that would give them whatever she had. Every piece of article of clothing, money, food, whatever she had, she would give them. Because living prophetically, central to this notion of living prophetically, is removing hardship from upon people. It is bringing relief to the humankind. It is not allowing for people to struggle who are trying to flee from war-torn lands, who are trying to find refuge. The spirit of the prophetic spirit is one to say, we will give you refuge. Our space will be a space of refuge for you because we follow in the footsteps of all of God's prophets, from Abraham to Moses to Jesus to Muhammad salawatu rabbi wa salamuhuma alayhim ajma'in. That is the spirit of a prophetic living. That you are in the service of others, that you take care of people's needs, that you want them to be comfortable, all as you sacrifice yourself. النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِ. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam takes precedence and is to be preferred in the hearts and minds of the believers over everything, especially themselves. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be pleased with us and to help us and to bless us to follow in the footsteps of our mother Aisha. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make her a beacon of light for us, someone that we take as a spiritual guide, an intellectual guide, someone who embodied the best of prophetic ethics, someone who truly was under the spirit of La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. May Allah be well pleased with her. And may Allah grant her the highest levels of Jannah to be in the company of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sins and our shortcomings. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. Brothers and sisters, in closing, the month of Ramadan is just over 2 months away. The month of Ramadan, as we all know, is the holiest month of our year. And it is the month where all of us will, بإذن الله, by his permission and should be seeking to strive to attain spiritual excellence, to attain ihsan. That is the month that we all as believers yearn for. The companions, 6 months before the month of Ramadan, they would begin to supplicate, "Oh Allah, grant us the opportunity to worship you in Ramadan. Allahumma ballighna Ramadan. Allahumma ballighna Ramadan." And so today, I remind myself and all of my brothers and sisters, Allahumma ballighna Ramadan. May Allah grant us the opportunity to worship him in Ramadan, to attain spiritual excellence in Ramadan, to realize this idea of prophetic living, to exist within the four prophetic spheres of knowledge, live spirituality, community, and service. And I close with one of the most beautiful dua, one of the most beautiful supplications that our mother Aisha taught us. Because in the last 10 nights of Ramadan, we know are the most special nights. She asked our beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, she said, "Ya Rasulullah, tell me words that I should say on this night. What dua should I make?" It was her request of the Prophet. And he said, "On this night, on these nights, say in abundance, Allahumma innaka afu, tuhibbul af, fa'afu anna. Oh Allah, you are the one who pardons, and you are the one who forgives. And oh Allah, you are the one who loves to pardon, and you are the one who loves to forgive. So pardon us and forgive us." We ask Allah, the one who is the pardoner, the one who loves to pardon our sins and our shortcomings. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be well pleased with us, to grant us the foresight and the wisdom and the understanding that was gifted to our mother Aisha. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to follow in her footsteps, the one who followed in the footsteps of her beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the one who he sallallahu alayhi wasallam kana fi sabilillah, he was in the way of God. May Allah help us to be on that path and to never veer off of that path. May Allah give us hearts and souls that are deeply spiritually connected to God. Those who pray in the night and fast in the day, those who seek to cleanse their hearts of all of its ills and all of its stains and all of its pollutants, and to beautify our hearts with mercy and love and compassion and reliance upon God. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are good to our families, who seek to make excellent our treatment of our families, to give us a strong and vibrant and healthy community. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who serve his creation, to serve every human being the way in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and our mother Aisha served all of creation. Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsani wa ita'i dhil qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun wa ladhikrullahi akbar wallahu ya'lamu ma tasna'un.